Hey, church family, I wanted to take this opportunity to present you with another word of encouragement as we continue to prepare for the Great Reset. Now, just to be clear, the Great Reset is a term being used by world leaders who are planning to use this pandemic to bring about what they're calling a new normal as they prepare to build back better. I think that Klaus Schwab put it best in an article that he wrote back in October. In that article, he declares, "No event since World War II's end has had as profound a global impact as COVID-19. The pandemic has triggered a public health and economic crisis on a scale unseen in generations and has exacerbated systemic problems such as inequality and great power posturing." Okay, so let me get this straight. The COVID-19 pandemic has revealed systemic problems all throughout the world, which is to say that there are problems in our current systems, which result in what Schwab calls inequality and great power posturing. Systemic problems, inequality, and great power posturing. All these things could be understood in a few different ways. And so rather than jumping to any conclusions right now, let's just consider the solutions that Professor Schwab is suggesting for these problems. Here's how he puts it. "The only acceptable response to such a crisis is to pursue a great reset of our economies, politics, and societies. Indeed, this is a moment to reevaluate the sacred cows of the pre-pandemic system, but also to defend certain long-held values." Now, according to Schwab here, the best way to solve the systemic problems that are causing all of the inequalities and is to pursue a great reset of our economies, politics, and societies. A great reset of our economy, our politics, and our society. According to him, this is the best way to stop the what he calls great power posturing. What is this great power posturing that he's talking about? Well, for the sake of clarity, the great power posturing that Klaus Schwab seems to be referring to, it's probably a reference to the military defense strategy and security of our nation. The reason I say this is because the latest watchword that's being used in the defense enterprise, it's the great power competition. What is this great power competition? Well, sadly, many experts are struggling to offer a succinct definition of what the great power competition is all about, and yet it seems to me that this has everything to do with who is truly in control of our military and our national security. You know that since the end of the Cold War that we have with the Soviet Union, the political establishment in Washington, D.C. has not only been conducting significant military operations in Libya and Syria and many other hotspots in the Middle East and North Africa, but listen, the United States has also been actively involved in expensive and seemingly endless wars in areas like Iraq and Afghanistan. And all of this, despite the fact that 75% of Americans think that the United States should prioritize domestic issues over foreign policy issues. Not only that, but 76% of Americans are in favor of bringing U.S. troops home from Afghanistan, and 74% of Americans support bringing our troops home from Iraq. And while it's true that most Americans are opposed to these endless wars, there are many deep state leaders who are competing for the control of our nation's military, and the reason why is because, listen, war is money. War is money, and it's simply that. According to one investigation, listen, 51 members of Congress and their spouses own between $2.3 and $5.8 million worth of stocks in companies that are among the top 30 defense contractors in the world. And 18 members of Congress combined own as much as $760,000 worth of stock in Lockheed Martin, which is the world's largest defense contractor in terms of overall defense revenues. You better believe that endless wars will guarantee the increasing wealth of these congressmen. With all that being the case, it seems to me that the great power competition has everything to do with making sure that this country is being run by leaders who are happy to keep our military actively engaged in endless wars, because war is money. And listen, this competition is not only occurring amongst the deep state leaders here in America, but there are also globalists like Klaus Schwab who are attempting to use the COVID-19 crisis to now flip the switch on a great reset with the goal of taking control of our economy, our politics, and our society. Listen, when global apologists like Klaus Schwab inform us that they're trying to bring an end to the great power posturing in order to establish equality for all, it's important for us to realize that the equality that he's actually referring to is more wealth for the globalists while the rest of us receive equal amounts of nothing. That's right. We're going to end up receiving equality as we get equal amounts of nothing. I can't help but to think about the prophecy that the Apostle John presented in Revelation chapter 6. There he declares this. He says, "I looked, and behold, a white horse. He who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer. When he opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature saying, 'Come and see.' Another horse, fiery red, went out, and it was granted to the one who sat on it to take peace from the earth, and that people should kill one another, and there was given to him a great sword. When he opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, 'Come and see.' So I looked, and behold, a black horse, and he who sat on it had a pair of scales in his hand, and I heard a voice in the midst of the four living creatures saying, 'A quart of wheat for a denarius, and three quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil and the wine.'" Now, according to this prophecy, there's coming a day when the Antichrist will begin to conquer all of the kingdoms of the world. And while this begins with a promise of peace and prosperity, it eventually results in economic collapse, which results in widespread starvation, equal amounts of nothing for everyone. And with that being the case, I can't help but to wonder how the great reset that the globalists are now promising, how this great reset might set the stage for these end time events to begin to happen. We'll consider more about this in weeks to come as we continue examining this great reset. Thankfully for us, though, listen, the church won't be here when the Antichrist takes the stage. When he rises up and begins to conquer, the church is going to be gone. With that being the case, I encourage every Christian to remember that we aren't called to look for the Antichrist. And you know, a lot of Christians spend their time trying to figure out who the Antichrist is. Listen, we haven't been called to look for the Antichrist. We've been called to look for Jesus Christ. And we've been called to wait for that day when the church will be carried away in the blessed event that we commonly call the rapture of the church. Until that day comes, I encourage every Christian, let's simply continue to fight the good fight of faith, all for the glory of God.